An hour is coming, and now is, when the true worshipers shall worship the Father in spirit and in truth. For such people the Father seeks to be his worshipers. God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship in spirit and in truth. So as today is Palm Sunday and we gather together to worship our Lord, we're going to have a palm processional as we think of this, the triumphal entry of Jesus into Jerusalem.
Okay, we're going to open the service with the Old Testament lesson from Zechariah 9, verses 9 and 10. Rejoice greatly, O my people, shout with joy, for look, your king is coming. He is the righteous one, the victor. Yet he is lowly, riding on a donkey's colt. I will disarm all peoples of the earth, including my people in Israel, and he shall bring peace among the nations. His realm shall stretch from sea to sea, from the river to the ends of the earth.
O glorious day, go ahead and stand with us and sing.
Jesus came forth to me, born of a virgin.
rising, he justified us freely forever, and one day he's coming again. If that doesn't get you excited, you might as well just leave right now. That's an open invitation, so you're all still here, so obviously you're excited to be here. Woo!
So Philippians 2, 5 through 11 is our epistle lesson. Philippians 2, 5 through 11, Jesus' name. Your attitude should be the kind that was shown us by Jesus Christ, who, though he was God, did not demand and cling to his rights as God, but laid aside his mighty power and glory, taking the disguise of a slave and becoming like men. And he humbled himself even further, going so far as actually to die a criminal's death on a cross. Yet it was because of this that God raised him up to the heights of heaven and gave him a name which is above every other name, that at the name of Jesus every knee shall bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue shall confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father.
Thank you.
And as we cling to that old rugged cross to exchange it for our crown, we come before God. That's the purpose of the cross, right? To confess our need before Him. And we'll confess our need. Our most gracious Father in heaven, we bow before you to confess our sin and seek your forgiveness. We have not esteemed you ourselves and have fallen into sin because of our own weakness. We know that sin leads us to death, but your gift to us is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. Strengthen our hearts against sin and forgive us when we fail. Grant to us the promise of eternal life with you in heaven and your grace to live here on this earth in Jesus' name. And he has indeed granted that through the blood of Jesus, his Son, right? Let's confess our faith. It's found in the words of the Apostles' Creed this morning. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he arose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated on the right hand of God the Father Almighty, from where he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
You may be seated.
Bell choir was enough, wasn't it? Our gospel reading for today comes out of Matthew chapter 21, and I'm going to read that. We're going to be looking at the epistle lesson, but I want you to know the gospel lesson because I'm going to refer back to it a couple of times. So Matthew records in chapter 21, as they approached Jerusalem and came to Bethpage on the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, go to the village ahead of you, and at once you will find a donkey tied there with her colt by her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, tell them that the Lord needs them, and he will send them right away. This took place to fulfill what was spoken through the prophet. Say to the daughter of Zion, see, your king comes to you gentle and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey. So the disciples went and did as Jesus had instructed them. They brought the donkey and the colt, placed their cloaks on them, and Jesus sat on them. And a very large crowd spread their cloaks on the road, while others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. And the crowds that went ahead of him and those that followed shouted, Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. And when Jesus entered Jerusalem, the whole city was stirred and asked, who is this? And the crowds answered, this is Jesus, the prophet from Nazareth in Galilee. So with today being Palm Sunday and the start of Holy Week, today we celebrate Jesus' triumphal entry into Jerusalem. And we had the wonderful palm procession that the kids did, the waving of the palms, and we get this whole idea of Jesus entering into the city with shouts of Hosanna. In the gospel message, Matthew wrote about it 60 years after it happened, and in the Old Testament lesson, Zechariah prophesied 520 years before it happened. So we see this whole story of Jesus riding into Jerusalem, and we see all the things that are going on, and the question I have for you today is, what does that mean to you? Why do we celebrate it? Is it just another one of those church things that we do? You know, another Sunday in church where we hear the same old story for the 700th time, and we have palms, and we do all these different things. What is the idea behind it? Why are we even focusing on this, especially as we enter into Passion Week or this idea of Jesus? Because we're looking ahead to Easter, aren't we? That's what the whole Christian faith is based on, is this idea of Easter. Jesus died, but he didn't stay that way, right? Easter Sunday proclaims he rose again. And that's what the whole idea is. So we have this whole story where people are shouting Hosanna and cutting palm fronds and laying them on the ground, and the donkeys walking through, and Jesus entering into town, and hundreds of thousands of people are there. But do you know that at this time in history, Jerusalem was probably at a boiling point in political and religious tension? There were all kinds of things going on that we don't normally talk about. And Passover, this time, this day, as a matter of fact, was particularly hazardous for the people. There were tens of thousands of pilgrims that flocked into the city from all over the known world. Some estimates, Josephus says that there were probably a possibility of 2 million people. And most scholars say, well, that's just too many. So they cut that down to 500,000 people. But that's still, you think of a town the size of Columbia Falls, and 500,000 people descending on it for a week and staying there. You can imagine people, if somebody asked me this morning, well, where did everybody stay? Right? You think about this. The city streets of Jerusalem were these little narrow streets. You know, they didn't have cars then, so people walked. So the little narrow streets of the city, people would set up little shelters in the streets, blocking off streets. People would set up tents outside the city walls. Of course, people would stay with friends and family and everything else. But the whole city would be swelled with all these people. It was a joyous and celebratory occasion, and yet people were under political tension. They were under all this fear of what was going on, because as the people gathered, work would stop, families would get reunited, there was food, there was wine, and every time you get people together and you start having food and wine, what happens? The discussions start, and they always turn to what? Politics, right? So all this is going on, and you think about, what is the purpose of the Passover? All these people are gathered together celebrating Israel's release from slavery from Egypt, right? And the ironic twist here is they're in bondage to Rome. So they're celebrating their freedom while being slaves of Rome. So you can imagine the political discussions going on. What are we going to do about this? How can we fix this? How can we get out from under this yoke of slavery that we've got? Josephus, as a Roman historian to the Jews, wrote, "It is on these festive occasions that sedition is most likely to break out." And it's recorded in his works that most of the riots that happened there, seven of them that I read about, occurred during Passover week. And in those riots, people were almost always massacred. So pilgrims go into the city and the riots start, or at least what the Roman soldiers think are riots, and the soldiers get nervous, swords get drawn, and people start to die. And of course, you know, the last thing the Roman prefect wanted was a riot in his town. So he would always bring in more troops. So there'd be lots of troops lying around. And we start thinking about that. And we think about this triumphal entry and all the stuff that's going on. And it really wasn't that at all. Normally, what it was, is it was more like a dirge march into the city, a death march. So people would be gathering to come into the city and come in through the gates, and they'd be quiet, almost dead quiet, because they didn't want to draw attention from the soldiers around them. They didn't want to be picked out amongst the crowd for starting a riot or something. And then all of a sudden, Jesus is entering the city, riding on a donkey with these palm fronds that set down. And by the way, the palm fronds really kind of represented the political state of Israel. That was on their coins. Not on Roman coins, but on Israel coins. The palm frond stood for their nation. So they have the palms getting thrown out, this guy riding in on a donkey who's supposed to be representing a king and going into the city, and people start to shout Hosanna, which literally means save us. But In church circles, we tend to think, okay, and we read that in the scripture, and we say, okay, it's this religious idea, but really, it's not a religious idea at all. It's a political statement. Like, release us from slavery. So all of these people are shouting these hosannas, and you can imagine what's going on. You can imagine why the leaders told Jesus in the Gospel of Luke to tell your disciples to be quiet. Right? Because it was going to start a riot. The soldiers were going to come out. And you can imagine why Matthew says the whole city was stirred wondering, who is this guy? So we have all of this stuff going on, and the question still rolls back to, what does this mean to you today? What did you take out of this whole idea of Jesus entering into the city today? With that triumphal entry on our minds, and with this whole idea of what's going on, Paul writes in his letter to the Philippians, have this mind among you, which Jesus Christ gave you. Even though he was in the form of God, he did not count an equality with God a thing to be grasped, but made himself nothing, taking the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men, and being found in human form, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God has highly exalted him and bestowed on him the name that is above every name, so that the name of Jesus, at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. The point is as we go through this day and as we step up and look at this week ahead of us, we are to have an attitude like Jesus. As we look at this triumphal entry and we look at what Jesus knew and what we know today, your attitude should be an attitude of humility, obedience, and sacrifice. Do you have a humble attitude? An obedient attitude? How about a sacrificial attitude? Do those thoughts even come to mind as we enter into this week? Paul starts off with the idea of humility. Do you understand that Jesus humbled himself at the very beginning? We usually talk about the humility of Christ during Passion Week, and we focus on it because of the cross and all that went on. But understand that Jesus' humility started at conception. Jesus Christ, the Son of God, left heaven, left perfection to come to earth. That is true humility. So I ask you, how are you doing with your humility? Is that something that people would make reference to you about? Oh yeah, that person, they're humble. I was going to point Daryl out. So yeah, Daryl, you all think you're humble, right? Sorry. I can pick on Daryl because he picks on me back and everything else. And I don't mean anything by it. The idea, though, is if somebody thinks of you, do they think of humility? Paul says in the text in his letter to the Philippians, he says, do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit, but in humility consider others better than yourselves. Do we do that? Is that something that we consciously do in our lives? Paul also goes on and he says, let each of you look not only to your own interests, but to the interests of others. You see, in our society today, we have gotten this take care of number one kind of attitude. We focus on ourselves before we even think about anybody else. And Paul says, you got it backwards. We need to be focusing on those around us. Paul says, consider others better than yourself. Do you do that? I mean, seriously, right? We usually think of ourselves first, and then anything that's left over, we might give to the church, or maybe even if there's some left over after that, we'll give to the people. And Paul says it's backwards. Right? He says, have a mind like Jesus. Jesus was, in the very nature, was God, right? And he said he did not consider to be He did not consider equality with God something to be grasped. The New Living Bible translation says it the best. He says, though he was God, he did not demand and cling to his rights as God, but made himself nothing and took the humble position of a slave and appeared in human form. God himself said, look, I'm God. I can do whatever. But he said, I'm going to give that up for you. Today. And because he did that, Jesus, Paul says, have this mind amongst yourselves. So we need to remember that God gave it up, so we need to give it up. Have the example of humility that Jesus Christ had. Jesus, who was rich beyond anything that we could possibly imagine, left it to come to earth for you. So as we prepare for Easter, as we go through this week, I want you to keep an attitude of humility about you. Remember what was going on. As Jesus entered into the city, he knew what lay ahead of him. He knew what was coming. It wasn't a surprise. And yet he went there anyway. So as we prepare, humble yourselves and step out. And then Paul continues with, and being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to death, even death on a cross. The next attitude that I want to ask you about is obedience. And this one always brings up an issue, doesn't it? Right? We don't like that word. Right? That's the law. The law kills. The Spirit gives life. Talking about that earlier today. And it's true, right? The letter of the law does kill. But do we have obedience? Did Jesus obey the will of his Father? Absolutely 100%, without even one jot or one tittle going out of place. Not only did he perfectly obey the law, but he obeyed everything about it. Even up to and including death on a cross. So we talk about obedience, and yes, Jesus obeyed the law perfectly because God requires justice, and so Jesus came and fulfilled that justice perfectly so that we don't have to. Jesus obeyed the law that we can never fully fulfill, but we still are called to obey, okay? We start talking about grace and forgiveness. Someone once told me that a gospel of grace that omits obedience is an empty gospel. And before you jump on me and start to think that you need to have grace or you need to obey to get grace, it's the other way around. You get grace and that helps you to obey, right? Because the whole gospel message is a gospel of love. Jesus emptied himself, poured out his love into our lives so that we can receive that love and obey the will of God. Right? That's what the whole point is. It's because of what Christ did, we can obey. Because Christ obeyed perfectly, we can attempt to obey in our lives. Jesus gives us a pattern to practice our life after, right? Paul says, have this mind about you. So we practice humility, we practice obedience. And it's tough because we don't like that, right? We don't like to follow that. But that's the way it is. So we humble ourselves and we obey. And then it gets to the sacrifice. Jesus was sacrificial. Paul writes in the book of Romans, very rarely will anyone die for a righteous man. And for a good man, someone might possibly dare to die. But God demonstrates his own love for us in this, that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. The idea of that while we were still sinners, it really says, while we were in the very act of sinning grievously against God, Jesus gave up his life for us. was of no benefit at all for Jesus to even come to earth. Jesus didn't gain anything by coming to earth. Jesus didn't gain anything from leaving his throne of grace in heaven and to live a life as a man in humiliation. He got nothing out of that. Jesus gained absolutely nothing by suffering and dying on the cross. But we have gained everything because of that. Because of what Jesus did, we have gained eternal life, haven't we? We have gained everything because Jesus sacrificed. So we go back into this idea of the mindset of Christ, and I ask you, where are you with sacrifice? How much are you willing to give up out of your life? You know, we strive hard, right? We work hard to get the things that we get. We work hard. That's the whole American dream idea, isn't it? Take care of number one, first of all, and then get what you can get while the getting's good. Right? And you got to climb up that hill and get what you can, get the bigger house, the better car, and on and on and on. And that's really what the whole American dream is all about, isn't it? But how does that fit with our Christian ideals? How does that fit with a mindset of Jesus? And there's nothing wrong with having those. Absolutely nothing, by the way. Scripture is very clear. We can have all of those things, but how much are you willing to sacrifice? The world's philosophy is look out for yourself, right? Success, wealth, stuff. But Micah tells us, Micah chapter 6, verse 8 says, "He has shown you, O man, what is good. And what does the Lord require of you? To act justly and to love mercy and to walk humbly with your God." But do you have a Christ-like attitude? Is your mind having the mind of Christ? Especially as we think of this triumphal entry, are you thinking what Christ was thinking? Are you having the same idea of being humble and obedient and sacrificial? As we think about Jesus riding into Jerusalem, as you think about all that's going on and all of the people and all of the turmoil, think about what Jesus was thinking. As Paul says, have that mind about you. And as we talk about this, we start thinking about this, we look towards the end of the week, right? Jesus dying on the cross. And we start thinking about that this Palm Sunday. But I want to point out that that is not the end. For believers, for those of us who believe in Jesus as our Lord and Savior, that is just the beginning. Paul continues with this verses. He says, "Therefore God exalted him," that is Jesus, "to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name." Jesus' very name means to save. Jesus came to earth to save the people from their sins, to grant us eternal life. Jesus died on the cross. We know that. He was laid in the tomb. We know that. But we also know and cling to the fact that he didn't stay there. He rose again. And that's the message that I want us to hold to as we go through this week, as we go through our lives, that Jesus died for our sins, but he didn't stay there. And we need to present that message in humility, in obedience, and with sacrifice. And with that thought in mind, I'm going to ask our youth mission team and those that are going on the trip, as well as our deacons that are here, to come on forward, because now is a good time to be commissioning our mission group. Let's get everybody to stand. Here we go. I'm going to have you guys read some scripture verses for me. Yeah, as the deacons will go up behind and lay hands on everybody. Bob, I'm going to hand you the first one. Read Matthew 28, 16 to 20.
Then the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain where Jesus had told them to go. And when they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. Then Jesus came to them and said, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always to the very end of the age."
Thank you.
Can I just say who else is going?
Please.
Okay, so Kiana, I say that wrong every time, is coming. She was one of the Series Juju kids coming with us. We have Emily, what's her last name?
Hove.
Coming. And then Sierra's not here. And
Sharon. Yep.
So.
David and Dana are
sort of
part of it. Yeah, they're going to be part of it.
And Callie.
And we just want to thank you so much for your generous giving to help us with the candy bouquets and the cookies and the Valentine banquet. Thank you. God is good. We have a vehicle to travel in, so just really appreciate my church so much, and thank you so much for your prayers already that you've been praying for us. And we have puppet ministry for in the parks and some face painting. We're going to do some stuff with kids. We're going to work, I don't know if you've heard all this already, but we're going to work with a food bank. They have a food bank that's really big in the Mesa Church that's going to be, we're going to paint in there. They give away 500 boxes of food every week, so it's pretty exciting for us to have that too.
Excellent.
After this, the Lord appointed 72 others and sent them two by two ahead of him in every town and place where he was about to go. He told them, "The harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Ask the Lord of the harvest, therefore, to send out workers into the harvest field. Go, I am sending you out like lambs among wolves. Do not take a purse or bag or sandals, and do not greet anyone on the road. When you enter a house, first say, 'Peace to this house.' If a man of peace is there, your peace will rest on him. If not, it will return to you. Stay in that house, eating and drinking whatever they give you, for the worker deserves his wages. Do not move around from house to house. When you enter a town and are welcomed," that's it.
How then can they call on the one they have not believed in? How can they believe in the one whom they have not heard? And how can they hear without someone preaching to them? And how can they preach unless they are sent? As it is written, "How beautiful are the feet of those who bring good news." Consequently, faith comes from hearing the message, and the message is heard through the word of Christ.
Thank you. So as we have these people getting ready to be humble, to humble themselves and be obedient to the word and go down and sacrifice, it's our job as a congregation to support them. Because the Bible declares that God has commissioned every Christian to make disciples of all nations. So these guys have responded to that call, right? They're going down there, and they're going down there with our name. So, with doing that, we would like to commission them. But do you commit yourselves to the service of God during this mission trip in response to his call on your lives? If so, answer yes with the help of God.
Yes, with the help of God.
Do you acknowledge that you can do nothing without the strength of God? And do you pledge yourselves to following his will and commands as you embark on this mission's journey? If so, answer yes with the help of God.
Yes, with the help of God.
To you, congregation of Stillwater Free Lutheran Church, being committed to God's mission in our own community and throughout the world, pledge yourselves to pray regularly for each member of this team during their journey. If so, answer yes with the help of God.
Yes, with the help of God.
May the grace, peace, and wisdom of the Lord Jesus Christ go with you as you serve. So, Daryl, will you lead us in a prayer as we pray over...
Father God, I just want to thank you, and I want to praise you for the heart that you've given for Danny. And Lord, I just am so grateful that he is willing to take these kids, spend time with them, nurture them, grow them up in the way that you want to. Lord, as they head out, I just want to pray that you'd give them travel mercies, that your angels would surround that van, that they would have a grand time traveling all night. And thank you, Lord, that I don't have to go with them all night. And Lord, I just want to pray that as they're down in Mesa, that the doors would just be open, that as they're in the parks, that people would just see you, Jesus. And as they're working in the food bank down there at Calvary, Lord, that you would just give them strong backs, that they can accomplish what they need to accomplish. So, Lord, I thank you that they have this opportunity, and I pray that you bless their time as they go forth. In Jesus' name, amen.
Oh,
this week, remember that the people you meet, you may be the only Jesus they ever meet. So bear that in mind as we go forth this week. May the Lord bless you. May the Lord keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. Go in his peace. Amen.